Yo.
Hey, Dave.
Hey, Zach.
How are you?
Just checking in.
Yep, this is a kind of a different setup for you this time.
Yeah, I just moved my spot.
Okay, very
From what?
good.
From where I usually sit or what?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Hi, Ed.
Hey, Zach. Hi, Dave.
Ed, where are you? You at home?
I'm at home. We got back
He's got a
in
fun
time.
digital background, right?
It's pre-Kincaid fire background.
Okay.
Are you up at a high camp?
No. That's just the background.
Mighty pretty.
Spiro emailed me. He is not participating today, which I think actually makes three in a row.
Yeah, so what are we going to do about that one?
I'll have to check your guys' bylaws. If you recall, we had that whole conversation about that a while back.
I
So
thought it was a three in a row.
it might well be. I'll take a peek at that and circle back with you. And then Erica emailed and said she's probably going to be running a little late. So pretty much as soon as we get Ivan on, we can get started.
Okay.
And I know Mitch and Hamid are joining us.
They aren't.
They are.
Oh, they are. Okay. So we can get the red curbs update from Mitch and the stop sign stuff from Amid.
Hopefully.
Okay. And Mitch was going to report out on the resort bike
Yep.
thing.
And we can Ed, we can chat about the survey, of course, too.
Yeah, Ed, you sent all that stuff to Zach already, right?
Yeah, if you'll allow me to share the screen, I can go through it quickly with people.
Yeah,
Just the early
we'll be able to
results.
do that when we get to when we get.
Right, the right place. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, we got about 5 minutes. So we'll give ready a few to jump on.
Sure.
Ed, did you get that stuff I forwarded you from Bob?
I did. Thank you.
Okay, great. Zach, there was a one thing I was talking to Bob Beck, and in an aside, he mentioned that a couple things that it just kind of, was interesting to me. There's the, do you know what the Butler Path is?
It rings a bell, remind me.
It's behind the Bank of the West parking lot, and it just goes through the cyclone fence, and then adjacent to the creek, and then over to Sharpstein.
Yes.
And it's all done except for it dead ends into the fence, and for some reason that was never allowed to be completed. I was
It's
just
called, we never got an easement out through that property to Lincoln Avenue.
okay. And
Believe me,
so
it is high on my wish list, but absent the city making an offer to them, really, unless and until either the bank or those two tasting rooms redevelop, it's going to be really hard for us to get that easement.
why is that?
Because we can't just go willy-nilly asking for that. I mean, we can ask, we're not going to get it. For a variety of reasons, we wouldn't want to run it through the parking lot. In a perfect world, that pathway would can continue along the river there, but that's of course where they have the patios for the wine tasting. So, someday I presume, those properties are going to redevelop into something more, intense, maybe multi-story, et cetera, and that would be the time to get that. But no, it's definitely a gap right there that we'd like to close. The Oddfellows building, they're doing the big seismic retrofit. There's actually a pathway right next to that.
Between the bakery, right?
Correct.
That's the other one I was going to bring up.
Yeah, and in talking to them, that one of the things they own that entire lot behind them that kind of goes with that building. And their intent is to sort of spruce that up, take down the fence, maybe connect it to the parking lot, future plaza area. And have some sort of pathway there. Maybe not as good as, a natural continuation of that path along the riverbank, but be a stopgap measure. Separately, I'm in conversations with Cal Poly's planning design class. They're looking for a studio project, and I'm kind of trying to pitch them on the whole Sharpstein Plaza idea to kind of maybe take that from a pie in the sky concept to something with some teeth in it. But you know, that's probably a little ways out still.
Have you seen all those files on the plaza, those drawings and all that conceptual drawings?
There's not a lot to the files. I think, you know, if I recall, when you first came on ATAC, you're like, we kind of did a search for those files. And to date, I have not found a file so much as a few kind of scattered references and site plans.
Well, I think I might have something, which I'd be happy to share with you.
Yeah, no, it'd be great. I mean, reactivating or activating kind of the backside of those buildings along Lincoln, cleaning up the area around the police department, you know, some sort of conversion of at least a portion of the parking lot, both the community center parking lot, maybe the Sharpstein Center parking lot, you know, maybe a little bit more of a formal farmer's market, sort of, you know, canopy plaza sort of thing. I mean, there's a million possibilities. You know, just kind of figuring out an actual plan to move that forward.
Zach, relative to the Cal Poly kids, is there any merit to asking them to, you know, reimagine Lincoln now that parklets are likely to stay?
Yeah, so, you know, I'm supposed to have another follow-up call with them, sort of a scoping exercise. I got an email a couple months ago, just sort of an all call, and I didn't have a solid project, but I figured something downtown or the Sharpstein Plaza would be a good direction to go. So, you know, depending on their capacity and how wide of a footprint they're willing to tackle, yeah, definitely downtown. You know, truth be told, in lieu of having students, I mean, bringing on a consulting firm to kind of take to the next steps, you know, as you know, Ed, there's a lot of challenges. And I've got attendees waiting to come in. I should probably let them in.
Okay.
Got distracted. Sorry, guys.
We still got a couple minutes.
Yeah, Ivan and Hamid. No, you know, between the Caltrans right away, you know, you got the canopies on the one side of Lincoln that, you know, are kind of a problem child, the landscaping issues, you know, figuring out a way to incorporate some additional outdoor seating on Lincoln, whether it's parklets or bulb outs or whatever. I mean, there's no shortage of things to unwind there. And unfortunately, it's all connected and all tied together.
Mm.
Here comes Ivan. Hey, Hamid.
Hey, Hamid.
Hello, Hamid.
You're muted, Hamid. That's okay.
Just waiting.
As usual.
I was going to tell you, since we're reopening to the public, that means you're going to have to clean that office up. I mean,
when are you reopening?
I forgot to blur out background. Sorry.
June 15th, we'll be opening the public areas.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
That's great.
Good afternoon, Ivan.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Ivan.
Hello, Ivan.
Ivan, I was telling the other folks that Spiro will not be available for the meeting this afternoon, and Erica's running a little late. So at this point, all three of you are here. I expect Erica to join, and then I know Chief Salai is going to be hopping on here hopefully soon too, but we don't necessarily have to wait on him.
Sounds good. Thank you.
I guess we got like 30 seconds. What speed cushions, before we start, I mean, is that something that who should be?
Yeah, so we'll try to maybe hopefully for the next meeting work on an item. You know, we'll need to bring kind of Public Works in and Steve, Chief Campbell, to kind of talk about that. I mean,
okay,
you know, it's going to involve obviously, okay, Fire's theoretically signed off on these. Now we got to get Public Works on board. And then it's talking about, okay, where would they go and how many?
Okay,
and,
yeah.
You know, then what do they cost and how do you pay for them? And all those sorts of fun things that, as you guys know, seem simple to answer, but in the world of city government turn into complicated, long drawn out discussions. But we'll do our best to move that ball forward.
Okay, yeah. I just wanted to make sure that we kept it on the radar so we can kick that can down to the next one.
Yep. And, you know, Diana and Carlota will both be really good resources for the speed cushion discussion as well.
Okay, good. Okay. All right. And with that, I would like to call the roll and we'll start the meeting. Ivan.
Here.
Ed.
Here.
Dave. Here. Zach.
Erica here.
Erica. Oh, hi, Erica.
Hello.
Okay. And I mean, I guess so we're ready to go.
We're ready to go.
Are there any public comments at this time?
I don't see anybody raising their hands unless anybody else out there. Oh, here comes Carlota.
Hi, Carlota.
Hey, Carlota.
Hello. just wanted to give a quick update on a couple things that we are working on here at the Bike Coalition. If I need to introduce myself for technical purposes, this is Carlota Sinato with the Napa County Bicycle Coalition. So we just wrapped up our bike month in May and just a couple of days ago. So we don't have our finalized review on how everything went, besides it went pretty great from my perspective, but we'll have more kind of technical numbers and feedback that we can present to the ATAC at a future meeting, just an update. And coming up on June 10th and June 16th, we are hosting two Safe Streets webinars, which I think Zach shared our flyers. So thank you, Zach. Those are webinars that we designed. They're about an hour long. They talk about basic bike safety, which is a great refresher for anyone who rides a bike. Motorist best practices for sharing the road with bicyclists. There's frequently a lot of questions about what do I do when a bicyclist is in the lane and there's no bike lane, do I pass? So addressing those common questions and helping guide folks to transition short vehicle trips to active transportation. So those webinars are open to anyone in Napa County and frankly, anyone. It's really great for organizations who might have a lot of folks biking or driving as part of their responsibilities. So I believe that flyer was sent out. I can send it out again if we want a refresher, but just letting you know those are coming up. And lastly, we are just making progress on our Safe Routes to School walk audit reports for the Calistoga schools. Finalizing our internal draft and then getting it reviewed by the city and the school district, as well as I think police department, and getting that formatted. So we are hoping to have an administrative draft to share with the city for their review by August. So Zach will be able to connect with you and give you more information on that ahead of time. But I just wanted to let the ATAC know that that is making progress. So thank you. And I'll answer any questions if you have any.
Thanks, Carlota.
Thank you.
I don't have any questions at this time. Anybody else?
No.
No, thank you.
Okay, next item is to adopt the agenda, which I think you guys have all got in front of you. So I move we adopt the agenda.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Old business. Ad hoc survey report. And that would be the ad hoc survey report.
Right. The resident survey has received over 300 responses to date. It remains open until the end of this week. A good response rate wouldn't have been possible without help from a lot of people, including Erica. Thank you very much. People like Kevin Eisenberg, Ruth Rodriguez, and a number of Calistoga organizations, ranging from Adelante to the school district. It was published, remind everybody, we published it as a flyer in the Calistoga Tribune. We took had a table at a couple of farmers markets. Erica worked the post office, CalMart, and a number of the food bank events, including some this week. So that accounts for what seems to be a pretty good turnout. And a few people submitted verbal comments. Zach, thanks for forwarding them on to us. The survey consists, you've all seen it before, but you know, basic questions on cycling safety, walking pedestrian safety issues. Then we tried to tease out the people that had children or the people that were doing those activities as adults. I can go through some of those very preliminary results, give you a taste for it now, if Zach, if you don't mind sharing the screen or allowing me to share my screen.
Yeah, do you not have the ability?
No, I can.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, great. All right. Do you all see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, great. So we ended up, at least to date, with about almost 10% Spanish language responses, 90% English. We also asked people, are you a resident or not? So you can see that we're just under 300 residential responses. I'm not quite sure who would not be a resident that responded to the survey, but I guess maybe the Tribune, the adjacent residences, I guess. And they're just running through this very quickly. You can see that most people, they walk and they bike. We're talking about the English language responses here. And when you come to, the initial results of safety, you see that most of the people feel safe or very safe. A substantial number feel unsafe or very unsafe. And that's just walking and the same for biking. And then when we ask, do you have children? The majority of the English language responses do not have children. Of those who do, and now I think we get into the area that is of special concern for all of us, the children, they walk and they bike. And then again, if you have children, how do you feel about safety when they're walking or when they're biking around Calistoga? So, again, speaking in generalities on preliminary results, there's a good feeling around basic safety. There's a substantial portion of the respondees who feel that conditions are unsafe. And I think that's sort of the initial easy part. What'll take longer is to, take a hard look and maybe develop some hotspots around the comments, around the intersections that people feel are troublesome and the reasons that they feel that they're troublesome. So there are a lot of comments, which is great. In this case, 216 people made comments here. And again, 98 people commented on, a second intersection or street that they wanted to make a comment on. So there's a lot of, I think, useful data here, but it will require some analysis. And then when we get down into the Spanish language commentaries, all residents, vast majority are walking and biking. And then of course, what is, differentiates this community from the English language responses is the very high number of them that have children that are walking and biking. And of course, they are walking and biking in the majority. And when you get down into the safety issues, a large percentage do feel it is safe, but a much larger percentage than the English language percentages feel unsafe. And so I think that's, worthy of further study as well. And again, lots of good commentary here. I think that is has a good degree of overlap, at least on my initial reading, with the English language comments, but then some distinct differences, which again, we'll have to look at it, but probably can be attributed to school children, school traffic patterns and things like that. So I will, we'll hand it back to you, Mr. Chairman. As noted, the survey remains open this week. will more carefully analyze results and on specific streets, intersections, safety issues, and report back to this committee.
Okay. Any questions from anybody on this so far?
Good job.
Okay, so Ed, it's and Erica too. I guess Erica, are you going to be continuing to man some kind of a activity where you're going to be passing out the surveys till Friday or?
Tomorrow, I'm going to go back to the post office because there's a great variety of people that use the post office. So there's a nice representation of the demographics. And that'll be my last. I never did make it to CalMart, but I'm just so impressed by all those responses and those people that took the time to write down those troublesome intersections and the difficulties. And that's just so great. Ed, thank you so much for doing all that.
Yeah, Ed, owe you a big thanks for that.
It was a group effort.
I have a quick observation. If if you're taking like a political poll or something, they say, well, so many percent of registered voters, whatever, and they only, they'll only poll, 1,500 people or whatever. We have 300 responses. That kind of rate of response would indicate a pretty accurate assessment. You guys think? Can we agree on that? Of conditions and how people feel or not.
Is that called leading the witness, Mr. Chair?
I just want to make sure that if we're going to make recommendations, it's based on, that information that really represents a real, a real concerns, real trends.
And the key with any survey is your cross-section representative? And if it isn't, how can you adjust, the outcomes to be representative?
I didn't mention, we did make an effort to get into the retirement communities on all three of them. And, to varying degrees, I guess, but we had it posted on their bulletin boards and handed out or posted via their distribution email system. So at least in broad strokes, we think we hit most of the segments of the community. I think they responded differently. I would have liked to have seen a higher Hispanic response rate, of course.
Yeah, and the school district just they just put the link out on their Facebook page. So there may be some more results coming in even after this week. So
yeah,
if you want a hard deadline to start collating these things or what.
And Ed, I just wanted to say that I know that some Spanish speakers, some members of the Latino community, still did the survey in English.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks, Erica. That's good to know.
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe it will say unofficially close this Friday, but if we still get, obviously, people that are still weighing in the next week or two after that, it's not going to be not counted, right? So. Mm-hmm.
Well, at some point, we have to formally close it, if only so that we can collate with the same, set of data. We all use the same data. So,
okay, in time for the next meeting, maybe.
Well, yes, yeah. I guess if you wish, we could leave it open until the end of next week, but that would be my recommendation, would be close it. There's a diminishing returns over time.
Okay. So, I'm okay with that. Everybody else okay with that?
Sure.
Yes.
Okay, so then it will be closed, and then would anybody like to volunteer to collate the comments and put them in some kind of categories of concern?
I would really enjoy doing that.
Well, good. Okay, so Erica, that's great news.
Erica, I can help you with that if it's, you don't mind some Zoom sessions. Maybe we can work on it together.
Okay, that would be fine.
Okay.
Yeah, I would definitely need direction.
Okay, so we'll leave that in your court, Erica and Ed, and should we expect then in our next meeting, you guys can report out on that?
Yes.
Okay, great. Excellent. All right. Okay, anything else on the survey report then? Any comments or questions or suggestions or anything?
No.
Okay. No. Okay, then let's move on to the red curb intersection stop sign discussion that we had last time. And I guess this will be, if the chief is here, or Hamid, you wanna start?
Yeah, we're gonna let both Hamid and Chief Salaya tag team this. I'm not sure which of you guys wants to jump in first.
Okay.
Well, I can start with kind of giving a little background just as a refresher. So, you know, there's a number of traffic safety issues, concerns in the city of Calistoga that have to do with vehicles mostly, but also pedestrians and bikes traffic. And so, as you recall, a few months ago, I had volunteered to have my staff go out and about and kind of look at the roadways and intersections in particular, because there appeared to be, or there are, a number of intersections that are really unsafe. We have many intersections that have narrow roads that come into more highly traveled roadways where vehicles are allowed to park all the way to the corner of the intersection. And, you know, if it's a little Mini Cooper, probably doesn't cause a problem. But if it's any regular size vehicle, a truck in particular, a box truck, those kinds of things, it really does hamper the ability of vehicles coming from our smaller roadways onto much larger roadways, particularly roadways that are more heavily traveled. And so the idea was to take a look at these intersections and see if looking at landscaping, but particularly curbing, red curbing, to prevent vehicles from literally parking up to the intersection, because the result is that vehicles literally have to pull into the intersection on oncoming traffic to determine whether it's safe to make. Usually it's a left turn, sometimes a right turn, depending on the intersection, but many times it's a left turn where they can't see the oncoming vehicles. It doesn't only just impact vehicles, but bicyclists. And as bicyclists are supposed to be safe in riding through bicycles, particularly at stop signs, they're supposed to stop. Well, many times they don't, but many of our intersections are not controlled. And so bicycles just ride through, which causes an additional issue for them, let alone pedestrian traffic. So I asked my staff to go out and take a look at some various intersections and come back to me. And what they did is they came down with 9 intersections. And I just want to say that there are probably many more intersections that you will probably say, well, what about this one? What about that one? And so what they did is they kind of looked at some of the more heavily trafficked, busy roadways and some of the smaller roadways that come onto these intersections. And presented these, and there are some pictures that were presented with the spreadsheet, but the intersections were mostly along Washington Street. There were some on Lake Street, and then off of Fairway. Those roadways tend to be the roadways where we get more vehicle traffic. Either people are cutting through town, or it's just they're heavily traveled because Washington, Lake tend to be wider roadways. Same thing with Lincoln Avenue. They did not include the Lincoln Avenue because Lincoln and Fairway and Lincoln and Stevenson, if they have not been done already, were already on the list to have some red curb painting done. And I believe the Stevenson and Lincoln has been done. I'm not sure about Fairway. I meant to drive by there to confirm that.
Yeah, I was going to say thank you so much because the Stevenson-Lincoln one is done and it makes a huge difference. It was really, really, a big difference there. So thank you.
Yeah. So Zach, I don't know if you shared the list of the intersections.
I did not. We can certainly do that.
Yeah, if we can do that, I'll just... Since there's only 9, I'll share them what they are. And it's Washington and Anna Street, Washington and Eddy Street, or Washington and Lake Street. So most of these, the red curbs would be on Washington because you have these people from these smaller roadways trying to exit onto Washington and the other way around. Fourth and Fairway, Second and Fairway, same thing. People are using Fairway and the smaller numbered streets that are trying to exit or trying to get onto those roadways have to literally get into the intersection before they can. The other roadways mentioned were Merriam and Lake Street, Merriam being a very narrow street, Lake being a very busy street, Hazel and Myrtle, and Brandon and Silverado. So this is really just the first blush at these things. You know, I think that my staff believe that these probably need more immediate attention, and then we can look at, you know, what the impact is and then how we might want to look at other intersections. And clearly you all can probably provide intersections you think are also need some attention. And so with that, I'll open up for discussion, answer any questions you might have, and then Hamid can address the issues of what it would take for Public Works to do it. And if they have any concerns about doing any red curb painting, or are there maybe other solutions that we can apply to these intersections?
Yeah, thank you, Mitch. So I got the list yesterday afternoon. I haven't got a chance to go over this and kind of look and see where they are, which corner of this intersection, and kind of dive into detail of each one of these intersections. So going back to two Fairway and Stevenson, yeah, they're both done. Give you an update on Fairway. We added 14 more feet, which is about one parking lane. So we gave up one parking stall at Fairway. So we have a total of 38 feet of red curb now at that corner. On Stevenson, in order to get enough sight distance, we had to add 45 feet of new red curb. So it's a total of 65 feet now there, but it's not so close to downtown, so you could compromise three parking stalls there. But it took about 65 feet of red curb to have enough sight distance at that corner. As far as this rest of this group, I will review those intersection one by one and see which one needs to have a red curb when we can, or there's issued more than a red curb. For example, at Stevenson, even with 65 feet of curb, there was some hedge plant in that corner in one of the properties that they had, it had to be trimmed. It wasn't worth notifying the property owner to trim their hedge plan. I had the guys, our guys, just trim it to get enough side distance. So there are other issues beside red curb that might be, we might have to address in each one of these intersections. A good example is that Washington and Lake is that solid fence and oak tree and a whole bunch of other stuff that we have to address. So I will review that and report back to the group in the next meeting on each one of those. But in general, red curb, is it comes down to maintenance and basically the budgeting for that. And I have to go and find a budget for it, for the, mainly the maintenance of it. We do once a year around June or July, we go and re-stripe. And red curb usually done in-house by our guys. But we do hire a contractor once a year to go and re-stripe center lines or crosswalks and the stop bars. And so it is kind of, we don't have enough staff to do more than once a year. And if it's gonna be more than what our two man crew can do, then we have to hire a contractor and then get a budget for it.
So Hamid, you know, when they do a red curb, it's a special paint, right? It's very durable. How long, what's the lifespan of a curb that's painted? I mean, it can't be an annual thing. It must last a couple of years before you have to go back and retouch it up.
Every other year we try to refresh those paints. And it really depends if they are like along Washington, get a lot of traffic, a lot of dirt and pollution on top of that, it just wears off very quick. But on side of the street, usually every other year.
And Hamid, what's kind of the status related to one of these intersections of a possible addition of some stop signs at Lake and Washington?
So that is the one that we're going to hire a consultant. We are, if we want to touch on that intersection, and Washington Street traffic calming is kind of goes hand in hand, and this too. We are getting some traffic data on that intersection in both directions. Thank you, Mitch and his officer. They installed the traffic count data box there in both directions. So hopefully we get some data. We know how much traffic going there, and then we provide that data to our consultant to come up with either a bulb out or reconfiguring that intersection.
So Hamid, are you saying that there's traffic counters out there, and if the ATAC really wants to see stop signs there, they should do a lot of driving through that intersection over the next couple days?
And run a stop sign, yes.
So Hamid, does that that work that's going to be done, does that can it also include a crosswalk through there? Is that part of the not only looking at is there a need for a stop sign, but also examining the area for a crosswalk? Because I thought that was an area that was identified as one that could use a crosswalk for pedestrian safety. And right. The red curb would work with that crosswalk.
Yeah, he has a crosswalk right now on one side, actually two legs. It's just, we're gonna look at that crosswalk configuration, see if it needs to be moved to the other side of the intersections, and probably a bulb out to have a shorter crosswalk. But it does have right now on the west side of the intersection, there's a crosswalk going across Washington.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I thought there was a discussion about, they can put those yellow flashing lights. So you're to push the button. So when you cross the road, it hopefully alerts a driver that someone's going to cross the road, since that is a thoroughfare, not only from the high school and the elementary school, but also to the Boys and Girls Club.
That's the kind of thing that would be needed if they weren't putting stop signs up. Hopefully, if they're putting stop signs up, you wouldn't necessarily need that activated.
Correct. Yeah, if it's going to be a three-way stop sign, then that would be basically the safest way or for crossing that intersections.
My vote's for the stop signs, Hamid.
Yeah. Hamid, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Erica.
Oh, no, I was just laughing in agreement with Zach.
Oh, okay. Hamid, I would just I'd like to say thanks again for the red curb at Stevenson and Lincoln. That's fantastic because I go that way every day. But in terms of putting in things like a stop sign, is it always necessary to have a consultant come on board and do all these studies and everything, which seem like they get pretty costly. And I know in looking at the results of our survey and whatnot, at least the preliminary results, there's a strong sentiment to putting a stop sign at that intersection. Is that something you could just do, or do you have to follow that entire long and winding road down there?
Yeah, it's twofold in that question. One is the issue we run into in this in town is when you have two streets with different classification, like for example Greenwood and Grant, we're talking about having a stop sign on Grant Street. So for that kind of situation, they have a minor road and a collector road, and we want to stop the traffic on the busier road, I have to hire a consultant to justify that. In this particular intersection, they're both roads, Washington and Lake, they're both same class of road, they're both collector roads, so we don't have to have a justification for that. It's to say it comes back to safety. At least the classification allows us to put a stop sign. But what I would like to do is more than a stop sign, because we have a sight distance issue there, is to have a consultant look at that intersection to come up with either to improve basically sight distance in addition to the crosswalk.
Okay, but the stop sign sounds like from your end, it's that's gonna happen?
Yeah, I ordinance wise and MUTCD or our vehicle code doesn't have any issue with putting a stop sign there. we were hoping to get more than a stop sign there.
Great.
How much does it cost for the consultant to, and how much does it cost to put in the stop signs?
So the stop sign.
I guess what I'm asking is it 100% necessary to do the consultant if you probably know the end result anyway? And if it costs 10 times more than putting in the stop signs, it seems like that would be not a wise way to spend money.
Yeah, so the consultant, the scope wouldn't be to look into if you need a stop sign or not. That's to improve the sight distance. If they're going to come up with either bulb out, where to put that crosswalk, and improve the sight distance that we don't have right now.
I guess what I'm saying is if it costs $50,000 for the consultant, it's probably, and it costs $5,000 to put in the stop signs, and probably everybody knows we need the stop signs. It seems like you should, you know, find a consultant locally or something. I don't know. It just seems like maybe I should go get my license to be a consultant for you.
Yeah, no, putting a stop sign probably doesn't need a consultant for that particular intersection.
Okay.
But it's going to be more than just a stop sign.
Yeah, I'm reviewing the municipal code, and the council can designate any intersection at one in which vehicles are required to stop, and they do that, then the stop signs go up.
Could I ask for a list of those intersections nominated by the police department? Because if we, whatever we do on the survey, it'll end up, the product will be some sort of heat map overlaid on the city. And it would be great to, at the same time, indicate those intersections noted by the police department. It's such an obvious question. If you could send me the information now, we'll include them on the same map.
If you're good with that, Chief Salai, I'll go ahead and send it out.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought that they were going to get sent out. I know that I didn't. It was my bad. I was gone most of last week, so I didn't get a chance to get it out till Tuesday. But I'd also like to ask Carlotta that for her input, because they did a walking survey. And so I would imagine that the issues that they identified, you overlay that on top of what you're doing and would probably really narrow down. These are the intersections we need to hit first.
That'd be great. That'd be excellent.
That'd be great.
Yeah. So.
And as far as the cost for the stop signs, Hamid, unless they've dramatically changed, I mean, to actually plant a stop sign, it's like $400-$800 plus whatever employee costs. You're talking $1,500 or less for an actual stop sign. I guess there might be a little extra for the paint that you have to put there, right? You usually put a limit line, but stop sign, any sign is not that expensive. It's the material cost of the sign.
Right. We don't need a consultant for a stop sign, and the putting it in doesn't cost much. But I'm hoping to get a better improvement at that intersection than just stop sign.
Mm-hmm. Well, but Hamid, also, when you look at a bulb out for an intersection, now you're taking more roadway space out.
Oh yeah.
So now, if you have, you're making a, I mean, Lake and Washington are one of our wider streets, but they're not really wide streets, right? They're wide compared to 4th Street, Anna Street, the numbered streets. So that's another consideration. You put a bulb out, yeah, it improves safety, but now you're also reducing the roadway.
Hamid, let me ask you this, kind of just speculating here. If the council approved putting stop signs up, how quickly could we put stop signs up at that intersection?
Within a week.
Okay.
We're just going to order the sign if we don't have it in the shop.
Got it. Okay.
Yes, of the nine things were mentioned, boy, that one seems like the biggest one that stands out in my mind is that lake in Washington. It's always been a problem. I mean, I'm halfway out in the intersection every time. And the other intersections, it seems like they're less, they're like when you come out on Merriam, it's not near as bad. You know, it's a much smaller street. And that, and the whole town, those are two very well-traveled roadways. It's a pretty, pretty big intersection, that one is. And if you're walking there or bike riding or driving, it seems dangerous right there.
Well, I have to say that Fairway, I sit at Lake and Fairway. And it amazes me how many vehicles are traveling down, up and down Fairway. And sometimes, you know, at a clip, maybe faster than the environment should allow for.
Yeah.
I mean, it's within the 25 mile an hour, but the roadway is narrow. And then when you have vehicles parked on the one side, it just.
That's a four-way stop there, right? At Fairway and Lake. Huh?
It is.
Yeah,
but when you go east towards Lincoln,
right.
There are no stop signs.
Right.
And you have those smaller roads and there's vehicles that park up against to the intersection.
Yes, you're right. That's a danger. That whole spot, there's construction going on out there right now too. So everybody's going a little slower, I guess.
Well, hopefully that kind of stuff's going to come out in the survey results and in when people get a chance to look at the
The idea of compiling the police report suggestions and Carlotta's report and the survey, we should have a lot of meat, hopefully, by the next meeting. So, I mean, I can tell you right now, Lake and Washington is far and away the most common comment in the survey results, yeah. In both languages.
Okay.
Okay. Then...
Chair Hagberg?
Yes, Erica.
I was just going to ask the chief really quickly. I think it's great about Anna and Eddie on Washington Street. I noticed also that Franklin and Gerard have the same issue, a small street going on to a larger street with, you know, fast moving cars. Yeah. And I know that Gerard already has a red curb, but it seems like that should actually be increased. And then I think Franklin doesn't have a red curb at all. And I'm just curious about making all those streets consistent going on to Washington.
Yeah, I mean, I think you make a good point. I think that because of how the residents are positioned, the reason why Anna and Eddie Street were on the list is because of the apartments that are surround that area. There's more vehicles that tend to park in that area, so it's a lot more congested. But now I don't know why Franklin wasn't listed.
Okay. I think it'd be good to keep right. Those consistent.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that this list of nine intersections isn't the only intersections we should be looking at. It was the ones that, you know, based on my staff who are driving around in circles out there, have immediately proposed.
Well, thank you very much, because it's a great first list, and I'm so happy about Stevenson. Thank you.
Carlotta, I'm seeing your hand up. Did you want to interject?
Yeah, I just wanted to, you know, wait till the appropriate time. I first wanted to just commend the work on the red curb, looking at the different intersections. It's really great to hear that we're looking at improving the safety of intersections and really for all road users. I know it seems like, okay, if there's a Mini Cooper parked up by the intersection, it might not be a big deal, but for a young kid who might be walking to school or a kid on a bike, they're just as invisible behind a Mini Cooper as they would be behind a big car. So it really does make a good difference. And it provides opportunities. Doesn't have to be right away, but a lot of communities have taken the space that has been designated a red curb and used that for increased bike parking, which does not affect the sight lines of pedestrians and motorists and bicyclists. So there are opportunities to continue using that space in the future. I know right now we're just looking at getting those red curbs put in. I know we briefly talked about overlaying kind of the feedback from the survey you're doing with what we heard at our walk audits. And we're certainly happy to work with staff and the committee on looking at those things together and figuring out where there's significant overlap. And I do want to mention Washington and Lake Street. I know that was a big thing that came up in our walk audits, both for the elementary school and the junior senior high school. Our staff has spent some time looking at it, and I just want to say I do think it's worth looking at more than just putting in stop signs, first because people roll through stop signs all the time. It doesn't necessarily it improves safety, but it doesn't have necessarily the same traffic calming or safety effects that other improvements which could be implemented in conjunction with a stop sign or without. So I think it is worth looking at things like bulb outs, which reduce the amount of time a person is actually in the roadway, reducing their risk of getting hit by someone who rolls through a stop sign, taking a right turn. So I just wanted to express that, and also always offer that the Bike Coalition is more than happy to help support city staff in researching and looking at these opportunities.
Great, thanks, Carlotta. Yeah, we'll be looking forward to getting together with you guys on your survey results as well as ours. And then and thanks a lot too for the you revisited the traffic calming stuff that we had talked about a year ago for Washington, I remember, and also for your work with the speed cushion stuff, which is really one of my pet peeves. So thanks for that. Anything else?
May I just follow up on one thing brought up by a citizen? Chief Celaya, at the exit of Saratoga Manor onto Lake Street, there isn't a stop sign. Is that because it's private property, or is there a reason?
You're muted, Chief.
Yes, because it's a driveway. So I believe Saratoga Manor has responsibility for that portion of the roadway. It's just like it's a driveway into a parking lot, basically. So it's private.
Is that something that the city could maybe request that the owners of the property install, consider a stop sign?
Yeah, I mean, there's a number of things. I mean, we can certainly ask the property owner or the association, you know, if they want to put a stop sign there. I mean, nothing prevents that. I'm not going to commit the city to it, but, you know, we can provide the materials and they can do it. I don't know what your thought. I mean, you're mute like me.
Yeah, you're muted.
Here you go. We do recommend property owners, mainly commercial and resorts, to put a stop sign there when they approach us for any particular traffic concern. But we don't put a stop sign there. The city doesn't. It's the property owners. They put it outside right away, basically facing their driveway. Good example, yesterday, 400 Silverado Trail, they just approached me for their driveway to Silverado Trail to put a stop sign there. And we told them basically the same thing. We recommend putting a stop sign, but they will be putting their stop sign. So these are property owners, they put this stop sign.
Because that's a very densely populated area with quite a few cars. And so it really is just like another street, you know. It is a driveway, but it feels like another street coming out.
And that was actually on the list. So the activist, our staff actually put that intersection on the list, Saratoga Manor and Lake Street.
Oh, great.
I'm surprised they didn't put the North Oak and Saratoga Manor driveway on there also, but I can see why they did Lake Street, because you're absolutely right. Lake Street does get pretty busy. Okay.
All right, thank you.
Okay, so we next is update, new business update from Public Works, but Hamid, I think you've already taken care of that. Or is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, pretty much all the projects that I updated your committee last month are still ongoing. The only new project coming up is next week, 400 Silverado Trail project. They will be widening bike lane along their frontage. So that's a northern side of the road. So they will be working 2 weeks starting next Monday to basically fix that bike lane along the frontage on Silverado Trail.
Hamid, could you also give an update on the AT&T pathway?
AT&T pathway, the decking, the framing and decking, and basically the pathway structure is completed. Contractor is working the two ADA ramp at both ends of the pathway on Lincoln Street and Lincoln Avenue and parking lot. And after that, they will be putting the railing and the fencing, and that would basically complete the overall project.
Hamid, you might talk to Derek about maybe us scheduling a ribbon cutting for that project.
Will do. Will do.
Will there be bollards blocking bicycles from using that pathway? Or something to discourage bicyclists?
No, we don't have anything. So it's a ramp, it's ADA ramp that's going up, but we will have a sign, no skateboarding, or basically, and also pointing to downtown and the public parking, kind of identifying the path. But no, right now we don't have any bollard or anything on the entrance.
Can you repeat where the work is being done on the Silverado Trail?
It's 400 Silverado Trail, AKA the resort at 400 Silverado Trail.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Chief, we still got you here. You were gonna do an update on the outreach to the resorts and their bikes.
Well, I'm sad to say I don't have much of an update. I know that I talked to the officer last week, and his response was he was waiting for the pamphlets that are still coming. So I think, Carlota, you may have some information, but I think Patrick was in the process of getting the educational stuff, the handouts. So we can actually, when we speak to the resorts, we actually have something that can say, here they are, you know, and you know, come to terms with, you know, how they should distribute those, you know, whether it's in the room or, because each resort has a different way of how they do the bikes. You know, Solage kind of leaves them out next to their bungalows where, you know, you have some of the other resorts where they actually have a singular place where you have to go get the bikes. And so that's a perfect place to pick up your information, as well as, you know, when they check in. And so I think the challenge is that it's going to be different for each resort. I don't think realistically we're going to get them all to do it the same way. So we're going to have to look at, you know, how their operations are and kind of tailor getting the information, you know, whether it's stickers on bikes or pamphlets in their rooms or handing them something when they check in.
Check-in seems to be pretty universally the same for everybody.
I can speak a little bit just on the progress side of that. So we developed some materials for both a short handout that is provided to the guests, and I believe information that can be placed on the bike with a sticker. Maybe those are just ideas, but we did develop the actual content to go at least in the pamphlets and pass that along to the city. So I believe it's under city review right now.
Zach, is that something that's in your office or is that, where's?
Yeah, I got that email from you, Carlota. I guess I didn't realize it was something you were looking for feedback on. So I'll make sure that goes to everybody appropriately. We'll get that done.
I think Patrick passed it on, and I'm not actually 100% sure who he passed it on to. So
I think it was from Patrick. It rings a bell. Let's see. Do. You know, I'll circle back with you guys on that.
How about
that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Okay. Anybody else want to chime in on any of this stuff, or we can move to future discussion for maybe the next agenda.
Yeah, not sure if this is the right moment, but I had a question about the Green Committee that was recently established. Is there intended to be any overlap there or joint work on, walking and cycling optimization as a more efficient form of transportation than cars?
It is not outside the realm of possibility. Unlike your group, you guys are ultimately charged with making recommendations and implementing the active transportation plan. There's no similar, document for the Green Committee other than, generally being charged with coming up with ideas and proposals to make Calistoga more environmentally friendly. But I think you're right. That's obvious. There is some natural overlap there. And, once we get that committee seated, I'm trying to schedule their first meeting right now. Maybe not too far down the road, maybe look at some opportunities for some collaboration or whatever it may be.
Just a small follow-up. I fully recognize that the survey results aren't even close, much less analyzed. But one common comment after Lake and Washington is cycling on Washington. And if we do hire a consultant to look at that intersection, I guess I would encourage that the scope at least consider cycling lanes or marking on Washington for bicycle traffic and things like that. It's a very common comment, and I realize that's a subjective comment of mine right now, but when the results are collated, you'll see a number of people commenting on that.
Yeah, we did talk about last meeting about marking on Washington, a shared bike path. So that is in order for that section in Washington.
Okay. That, yeah.
And
the commentary goes all the way down to Lincoln, not just that one section. I realize the two schools are in that one section, but the commentary goes all the way down to Lincoln.
And I would imagine that some people who are referring to Washington also might be referring to East Washington down towards the bike path.
Yeah.
So they may not have specified which part of Washington, but it probably is both.
Yeah. So if anybody is interested in the preliminary data in its raw form, I'm more than happy to provide it to you. So just let me know. That I'll take out some of that. There's some personal email addresses that still need to be taken out. But after that, it's it should be available if you want to take a look at it.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. For next time, my notes say that we're going to probably look for a report from the survey. You think that'll be collated in time for that, you guys?
Assuming we can get your translation help, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. I will get on that.
All right.
Or Zach, you're going to hit up Claudia too, right?
Yeah,
we can probably do a little bit of support from the city on some translation. It should be relatively straightforward.
It is.
It's pretty, there's only a couple of words that I was like, oh, I just learned a couple new words. It was good. Okay, so that we'll put that on next agenda. The resort bike pamphlet update, maybe how that outreach is going. Is that going to be okay by then too, Carlota, do you think?
I can't say for sure.
TBD, we'll all do our best.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, and then the speed cushion thing, which I have a big interest in, I don't know how we go about doing that.
So we'll probably need to circle back with Chief Campbell on that. There's that's not one that's going to be solved overnight. No. I think as you all recognize, getting the fire chiefs buy-in, at least conceptually on that, was a big first step. So, you know, maybe staff might need to huddle internally and kind of strategize, and, you know, maybe ambitionally we could bring something back to you guys here in a month on that.
Okay.
So Hamid, so it's been my experience that the portion of Public Works has had issues with cushions or speed bumps. Where are they on this?
So I need to talk to Derek about the budgeting for this. This comes down to the budget and the maintenance of that.
Okay, so that's the only objection that you guys have is the money?
Everything's money.
Yeah, I know, but not philosophically or equipment oriented.
I know there is issue with certain type of those cushion with our sweeper, but I believe there are a certain type that they can work with the sweeper, they're safe.
Okay, so we'll just kind of start kicking tires on that.
Well, can we do this? I know it's an investment, but can we buy a cushion or see if a company will lend us a cushion, you know, to actually, because sometimes seeing it, touching it, you know, put it on a roadway to get a real feel for, you know, what it looks like, what it feels like, you know, as opposed to we talk virtually about these things, you know, it's kind of like doing, you know, virtual buying online, right? You don't really know what it's going to be like until you actually get it. Then you realize, why did I get this? This isn't what I thought it was going to be. Sometimes companies will send you out an example one that you can put out. We're farther along and away from the pandemic that we could probably gather as a group to pick a road and throw it on the road. I can block the road so we can be safe.
Diana Meehan is on the call. Are you available? Do you know of any that are local already installed in the Napa area?
None that I know of in the Napa area. We do have some speed bumps in the city of Napa. There's very few small neighborhood streets, but we don't have any cushions that I'm aware of.
Our staff noticed just today that there are speed cushions. It's not on an official street, but they are all over the place in the American Canyon High School parking lot, including on their fire access road. So I'm guessing their fire department was in on it, but that's something our team can definitely look into more.
Fantastic.
We just noticed it today, so we're excited to see that.
Interesting. Well, that's, you know, maybe you can borrow one.
would there be grants available from Safe Routes to School for something like that? If they were placed in an area that's heavily trafficked to get to and from school?
There are active transportation grants for a lot of different types of projects. I think there is a big benefit that, especially since we're looking at Grant Street, that Grant Street is a main road to schools. So it's definitely a benefit for grant applications. I don't know specifics about all the possible grants that there could be. I bet Diana knows more than I do on that.
Okay. Well, I can say the TDA 3 or Transportation Development Act funds, which are in Article 3 is exclusive to bike and pedestrian, has added quick build type projects into that fund source. And I can tell you, we do a 3-year call for projects. We're gonna be taking it to the TAC, but it's, that project is completely at capacity for the next 3 years. There's always way more ask than we have funds available. We literally bring into the county around $150,000 a year for many, many projects that are kind of lying in wait. So, but that said, if funds come in higher, we always do kind of a true up at the beginning of every year. March is usually the month. And, you know, I won't say that there will be extra funds available, but sometimes there is a potential for that. And I don't know if Air District funds would pay for something like that, but, you know, there's a lot of discussion at the regional level about quick build and quick strike projects. They're just starting the process of doing a regional active transportation plan, looking at complete streets, all these things. And like I said, lots of discussion about what we call quick build projects, which can be designed to trial or test different types of these different types of things. So
Diana or Carlota, do you either of you have any idea what a speed cushion costs just off the shelf?
I was just looking when you guys brought it up, and it looks like, you know, varies quite a lot. They look like you could probably purchase one in the, you know, see some as low as $500. It depends on what you're installing.
Sure.
You're going to do a split cushion and, yeah, I don't, they don't look that expensive.
Okay.
They're less expensive than I thought.
In the short write-up I did on speed cushions, I did not specifically look at costs. I looked more at how they worked with their fire departments and how the speed cushions have been working on curbing speeding. But I am sure that looking back on those resources, it's possible that those articles or contacts might have more information on the funding. I just wasn't looking specifically at it at the time.
Yeah, it looks like I'm seeing it, you know, they look to be in around the $1,000, you know, $1,000 range is what I'm seeing.
So Carlota or Diana, if you have the vendor information or sales rep information, sometimes as a police representative, I can sometimes make a call, and a lot of times, because they want our business, is they'll send out one
for get a sample
use. It's like radar sign. I got a couple of radar signs when I first was looking at them. They go, "We'll send you one," and you know, you have it for like, you know, a month or two, and then you got to send it back, or you know, you buy it. And so, if you want to send that info to me, I'm more than happy to make a phone call and use my stars. Sometimes it doesn't always work, but sometimes I can. Get them to say, "Hey, we'll send you out something," and then we can actually have it.
Yeah, I only have one website off the top of my head that I looked up, but I can find a couple more sources. Diana sounds like she's looking at sources. So
yeah, there's a bunch of them out there, and
that's great.
Here's one that says this is in Phoenix, and it's they're cost quoting this at $5,500, but that includes the cost of the cushion, the signing, the striping, installation. It's more than just the cushion itself. There's a whole bunch of things. And it does sound like you have to sign these. You have to put a sign up that warns the drivers that this is coming up.
I found one on recycled rubber speed cushions that
$1,995.
I'll do a little
special
digging
this week. Well, let's talk about it at the next meeting and see what we've come up with. How's that?
Sounds great.
In agreement for that? Okay. Okay. Then the last thing I got is the Washington Lake stop sign push out consultant. All that, is that too soon, Hamid, for a month from now?
To get a consultant? Are we still moving in that direction, or?
Well, were you thinking about putting a sign in before that, and then, or do you need to have all this information from that guy to decide where you want to put the sign and how you want to do the crosswalk and if you need a crosswalk, or all that stuff?
To moving crosswalk or shortening or changing the layout, I would be comfortable having a consultant recommending the layout to me.
But can we put the stop sign in before
for
that?
A stop sign? No, it needs to go to city council and put the stop sign there.
Yeah, we're going to look at taking that to council.
Okay, great. So then by a month from now, we should see a stop sign there, or hopefully, or not.
Well, we'll see how quickly we can get something to council, and then how quickly Hamid can get some stop signs ordered. How about that? And then we'll schedule another ribbon cutting for you guys.
Yeah, exactly.
We'll be there.
Sure.
Okay, items from staff.
You know, the only other thing I wanted to mention, I'm getting ready to hire another planner here. Hopefully they're going to start in July. I've been short-staffed for more than a year, so I'm thrilled to have a planner on board. The person we've extended an offer to seems very enthusiastic about active transportation, as well as some other initiatives. So it is likely that person will, over the next couple months, transition to serving the secretarial role for your group. Doesn't mean I'll go away completely, but that person will be probably taking over to a large degree.
Mm.
So stay tuned.
Well, you've been wonderful, Zach.
Yes.
You really are.
Well, you guys are a pleasure to work with. And like I said, I'm not going anywhere.
Good. that's the last item from staff, I take it. So that's it. I move we adjourn until next time. Anybody else?
Yeah, and just real quickly, that next meeting, just for everybody's calendar, is July 7th. I know that's relatively quick after the holiday, but that is when it is scheduled for.
Okay, very good. Okay.
Oh, and will we be able to meet in person?
Stay tuned.
Okay. Let's hope so.
Yeah,
it's quite likely that you will meet in person, and it is quite likely it'll be over at the community center. We've just got some logistics to work through.
Great. Okay.
Good.
That's great news.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
And we'll look forward to seeing you all next time.
Thanks, great. Everybody.
All right.
Thank you. Move to adjourn. Bye-bye.